Hey friends, on an earlier episode of Azure Friday, Bruno Borges came by to talk about Java development with Microsoft in general and Azure in particular. But we ran out of time with part one and we didn't get to see it in action. So now, part two, Rory Preddy is here to show me all the fun Java episodes we missed in that earlier episode today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Rory Preddy and we're going to hear some more great stuff about Java on Azure. How are you, sir?
I'm great. I'm from Johannesburg, so it's great to actually speak to the crowd around the world. If you hear my South African accent, it is very deep. And I've got some incredible stuff to show you about Java, Azure, and also the incredible developer experience that we have for the Java developer.
I love it. I want to see some live demos. I want to hear about the power of open source and the power of Azure today.
Okay, so the first thing I want to do show you is how easy it is to get started with Java and VS Code. So I've installed Java and VS Code here, and the first thing that it does, it actually brings up a help center here. It's our new help center, and it says, okay, cool, what do you want to do? How can we help you? But it says, do you want to create a new project? Do you want to take a tour? And then it gives you all of the nice little settings that you might stumble on. And one of them that we're going to demo today is I've taken one of the projects that we have here. So if you go down to Spring, it says the Spring Pet Clinic sample application. So I've set up my PC with the Microsoft OpenJDK. You can go into configure your Java runtime, and then set it up with the Microsoft OpenJDK. Now that's our version of here. And I've downloaded the Spring Pet Clinic, and I've done a little bit of configuration to make it a little bit more optimized. So the Spring Pet Clinic, it's a nice little application that says, here's owners, pets, and vets, and you wanna take your pet to the vet. So everything is running and ready. And if you see here, I've got my project here, and I'm gonna show you some stuff that you can get started with today, Scott. And it's pretty simple. And that's our setup done here. So the next thing I want to show you is the classic Java project here. You've got your source files, you've got your POM, and everything is kind of built in. You've got Maven here, which is our build script, kind of like NuGet NPM. I don't actually know if you use MS Build, but very similar to that. And I can right-click and I can run the project here. But I want to show you something else here, because we've built in some new screens recently. Since Bruno spoke to you on the session, we've actually built in some screens. So watch this. I've got the Spring extension, and I'm going to click on the actual project here, and then I'm going to go debug. Now, I sat with your friend, Burke, and I showed him this, and he went, Rory, give this to other languages. Because what we're doing in here, in this project, is we were actually going into all of the beans, you know, the objects there. We were interrogating them, and then we're saying to them, okay, what do you do? How can we access you? And how can we test you? So I've got my debug on here, and look at that. We've got all of the actual objects here. If I go into owner controller, and then I've got some gray text here that will tell you what you're doing. But more importantly, look at that, Scott.
Got... Look at that. So you're introspecting into the running Spring app, and you've identified each bean, you've interrogated it, you know what ports they're listening on, and then you've added a little hint above it in the for each of those mappings, for those REST APIs, those little microservices.
And you can only do this in Java, because the Spring actuator allows you to introspect all of those objects. Now, I can actually go in there, and you can see there I've got my REST calls here, but I want to show you what this app actually does. I can just click on the app here and it will open up, and this is my pets here, and I can go find owners, and I can just click on find owners, and then it's gonna debug breakpoint into here, and I've got all my gray text there also, and I can see there I'm checking whether the owner.lastname is blank, and I can go through that, and I can also go through the classic watch and debug experience here. So let's go owner. You can see there I've got all of that niceties, the classic kind of .NET action going on there. But one thing that I really wanted to show you is it's got also some of the newer features like hot code replace, and also your what we call it in there, your debugless debugging. So if I click on continue here, it's going to go through here. And I can actually go in here, instead of saying owner last name, I can just go owner last name. And then if you click on hot code replace, you'll see there are three changes loaded. And now I can actually go in there, it says owner last name. So I'm going to go back into my Microsoft, the simple browser here. And let's go into here, find owners. We're going to find the owners there. And let me just click that debug point off there. But the class has actually been hot reloaded without me doing much. So it's an incredible debugging experience that we have with the URLs, the endpoint mappings, the beans. But we've got a little bit more here. What we've built into here is the ability to to introspect your heap memory. You can see there, there's my resources, my non-heap memory, my GC pauses, garbage collection pauses, and also my garbage collections. Look at that. I can actually go and hyper-optimize. And this is built in to the Visual Studio Code extensions that you get, all driven by Microsoft and also overseen by Microsoft, but part of the open source initiative that Microsoft has on the VS Code extensions here. So my entire debugging and experience here allows me to go in there to test my capabilities. And once I'm finished with that, I can go into code spaces with the exact same experience. So I'm going to drop off into here. I'm going to just go stop there. Now I'm going to go into Microsoft code spaces. You can see there my actual Edge browser is using a different theme that I have here. But this is code spaces. Now I want to do Docker and I want to get this onto Azure. So how do I do this? So I've got
let me level set for a second. I want to understand. So before we were on localhost.
Yes.
We were on, right. And we were doing our local development still in Spring. Now we're in a code space, which is a different flavor of localhost. And then we're going to make the jump from this cloud-based development environment into Azure proper. Is that correct?
Do you know why I do it in code spaces? Because this one that I'm using right now has 32 CPUs and more memory than I've had hot meals. And as a result, because if I run this locally on my laptop, it's going to complain. And over here, I can get all of the benefit of running this on Docker and seeing exactly how I want to run it on my Azure Container Apps. So I've got my actual app here. I'm using the supported versions of the Docker file. I'm exposing my port. We use 8080 here, not 3000 in .NET world. I've got my app that I already got. And then what I do here is the newer features that we've added to Java 17 allows you to hyper-optimize your Java for a container. And what do we really, really want to run this on is container apps. But I want to say, here's my app. Only give it 75% of the memory. Let the other memory go for the other processes. So I've got my memory here. I've got my entry point. Now, ironically, I actually created that with Copilot. You can see they create a Java endpoint and make the maximum, and it actually goes in and creates it for me. So I can just go right-click and on Docker. Now, this is where sometimes I get a crowd, ooh, ah. I'm about to build a Docker image in code spaces, and then I'm going to go into my Docker file here, and I'm going to right-click on there, and I'm going to go run interactive. So this is Docker and Docker and Docker. So I can actually go and do proper testing here. So I've got there and I can go open in browser. Now I can actually say, well, the Docker file's running. Everything is ready. Let's just do that and let's go. There we go. Nice. I was too eager. Find owners.
Nicely done. Did you just say that it was becoming dockier? I think that's a word
Dockier, yeah.
Now more and more dockier as we move into the cloud. I love it.
I've got 32 CPUs in memory. Why would I not want to use Microsoft code spaces? The last thing I want to do over here is I want to actually check on my local instance here. Let's go back here. And I know that Bruno promised you playwright tests. And over here, I've got my playwright tests here. And what this does, let's go into test here. under tests. And player out test is going to do my final integration test. And this is going to run in our build process. It's basically going to go in, create an owner here, and I can just right click on that. It's running a proper Chrome browser, and it runs on the GitHub Actions to say, end to end, I want to run that tester. You can see there, it's busy running here. And it's going to run the end-to-end test there. It goes running test here.
So you're running the Playwright test headless in a container against the Java Spring site.
Yeah, and I can run this in Docker also, except sometimes Codespaces doesn't like you running errant browser processes in Codespaces.
Yeah.
And that's what that's kind of picked up though. So everything's done. I'm happy with my development. I've got my local development. I've got my actual Docker development. So I can actually go and push this. I'm going to push this locally here. I can just go, okay, cool. Everything's right. I need to make a change here. So the powers that be can actually go in and say that. Let's just make a small little change here. I'm going to push that there. I'm going to commit for Scott. And I'm going to commit and push. Once I do that, I use the app command in Container Apps. It set up everything for me. By going to GitHub Actions here, everything from the start has actually done, even added CodeQL analysis for me here. The only thing I changed here is I want to use the Microsoft OpenJDK. Call me a spoiled for choice here. I've got the Microsoft OpenJDK. I build it exactly like I did in my process. I log into my container registry. It went and created all of that for me. Container registry, Container Apps, GitHub Actions, all of that, just with one command. I was blown away. It's going to push it to the container image. It's going to then log into my Azure. I do need to go in there and give it my credentials, which are secret. And you want to put that in a key vault also. And then I'm going to go create my image and then update my image. Now, when I did this initially, we did this late at night, just before Bruno and I did a live build there. And the irony is it was incredibly easy to do and incredibly quick. I want to show you here. So here's my repo that I keep here. And on my actions here, you'll see there that we've got our actions already built. Now, CodeQL is just checking for any weirdness that is coming in here. You can actually get it to check for injection, SQL injection. And there is my trigger that the Container Apps app actually created. Let's go in here. It's building it with the Microsoft OpenJDK. I've already tested that my Docker image works locally, and I'm happy with that. It's going to build the local file here, and then it's going to go into the deploy. Now, the deploy is very interesting because I am deploying to a container app. Now, I've set my container app to only handle one revision because I don't want to go in there and create a staging environment live on air with you. So when I do a deploy, it's going to go into, let's open up the Microsoft Azure portal. It's going to go overwrite all the previous revision, which is fine with me. But if I wanted to do some traffic shaping or any other services that are related to versioning, I might actually not want to do that. So here's my actual container app here. And I want to show you live that this is actually working here. You'll see there when it finishes there. So let's go into our container apps, into our revision management. And I've set it to single revision on container apps. We're already happy with our Docker file. We've set up the ports. It'll already pick that up there. And it is going to overwrite that revision there. I've also set it to the scaling, to not scale, but to rather also give it two CPUs and 4 gigs of RAM. Java is a little bit greedy, I would say, when it comes to memory. We also set it to 75 on the Docker file there. So the max replicas here. And then on the actual replicas here, if you want to go through that, you'll see that I've actually set it to, let's wait there, and let's go into our scale. Two CPUs and 4 gigs of RAM. Let's go, it's finished here. It's finished. I've got my deploy process here. Remember, all of this was set up with container apps up here. Got my complete job deployed to my apps here. Now I should be able to go into
What are the chances that this works on the first try without a net? Zero, Rory. There's no chance that this works immediately.
But it makes the audience want to root for you as the underdog. There's my app there. It's already got, so today's the 5th. It's already pushed the traffic there to 100%. So I can actually go in there and go into overview. Now it's going to use very basic load balancing to point to that revision. I can actually go to the revision of myself here. Here's my application URL. Easy process.
Quick. Oh, my goodness.
So it's easy to set up. It's easy also to debug. We've got some incredible screens there that no other language and product actually has. It's easy then to migrate to get drunk of power of code spaces. You can do your integration test there with Playwright. And then moving off to Container Apps, just with Container Apps up, you've got all of that nice GitHub actions into Container Apps. Now, this app here, it's cost me about 3 cents over the period of about a year to run, because I only really do it on my demos. I spin it up, and then it comes down because it's scaled to zero, so which is a great cheap way for me to keep my app running. That's everything I wanted to show you today, coming back to our original session. And yeah, I got Scott Hanselman to be really impressed and surprised at the really colorful and powerful ecosystem that Microsoft has with Java.
Absolutely brilliant. Very nicely done, sir. You stuck the landing. I didn't believe it was possible, but I am learning all about Java with Azure today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.